snuck back there real quick, got a water. I give you, what's the verse? Come to me, all you who are thirsty, and out of your belly will gush forth torrents of living water. This spake he of the Holy Spirit. But I'm also thankful for actual water. Okay, we better have fun today, because I had fun the first service, and I want to have fun this service. So can you guys be like alive today? Is that okay? Okay, good. Cheers. That's the kind of cheers we do at Applegate. We do water cheers. Okay, I wasn't supposed to go into this, but some people, like, the Bible says, do not be drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. Some people get hammered when they're depressed, hammered when they're down. And I think there's power in sublimating the whole thing. Like, I love how Jesus compared the Spirit to water. Like, when you're just super down and super depressed, what if instead of going to, like, the liquor store and chugging wine, I think of this, like, what if you just get tons of water bottles and just start chugging, like, I'm ticked. Rivers of living water. Life is so brutal right now. That was just my excuse to get a bunch of chugs of water without awkward silences. No, but like seriously, I know this has nothing to do with anything, but I bet it'll help some people. Like, what if instead of just doing destructive things when your life is already being destroyed, you actually did health-giving things? Like, oh, it's such a bad day. Sorry, dude, I'm just chugging water. Like, that'd be powerful. I don't know. I think it's helpful. Okay, well, I can't tell if that was a bomb or a hit or something of a mix. A mixed bag. Okay. Let's do this. Acts, let's go there. Father, please speak powerfully today. We love you. We need you. Deep calls into deep at the noise of thy water spouts. And we pray that this heavenly water, that we be washed by the water of your word, that you would give us water to drink and food that we know not of, that we would get this manna from heaven, the bread of life. And feast on encouragement, nourishment, milk, meat, and manna. In Jesus' name. And all God's people said, Amen. Good news. 25% of the people you meet will never like you no matter what. Welcome to church. Good morning, everybody. I'm not pulling this out of the deep feeds or deep weeds or tall grass of left field. Sociological data and research and studies, I found this a few years ago, have shown that 25% of the people you meet will never like you, no matter what. Hello, everybody. Great to see a smile on your face. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you. Like, Ben, what a depressing fact. Actually, it's super freeing, because when people don't like me, I can just say, hey, it's part of the data. It's bound to happen. No matter how likable of a bloke you are, you're always going to have your detractors. So 25% of the people you meet will never like you no matter what. You could buy them a car and still they wouldn't like you. Let me ask you a question. Have you ever said, no matter what I do, I cannot please that person? Have you ever thought those words? That's because that's gonna happen to all of us. The data shows us 25% of the people you meet will never like you. The second set of 25% of the people you meet, studies have shown, research, sociological data has revealed, the second set of 25% of people you meet don't like you, but they might change their mind. The third set of 25% of people you meet do like you, but might be persuaded not to. And the final 25% of people you meet do like you, will always love you and support you no matter what. But that consists of mothers and they have to like you. So, don't trust your confidence to the poll data, because people are like snowflakes. They're beautiful and unique. No two snowflakes are alike. Humans are beautiful and unique like snowflakes, but we're flakes nonetheless. Can I get an amen? Like 50% of people will change their mind about you. And the truth of the matter is, Winston Churchill, when he would like go speak, he would pack the halls to overflowing. And somebody asked him, how does it feel to like pack him in like that? Like whenever you go give a public address, the halls are packed to overflowing. Like, how does that make you feel? And Churchill replied with his witty repartee and riposte. He said, oh, it feels fantastic until I remember that twice as many people would come to the halls if they were coming to see me being beheaded, as opposed to if I was giving a speech. Twice as many people would come if I was getting beheaded rather than giving a speech, because he understood that popular opinion is the judgment of the incapable many as opposed to the discerning few. So he didn't trust his confidence to the poll data. Because the truth of the matter is, listen, the fear of man bringeth a snare, but those who trust in the Lord will have safety. This is something Paul had to learn in a very, very powerful way in Acts 14. We're going to start in verse 8. And the reason this message is burning on my heart at the moment is because we live in a day where a lot of my generation finds our identity in what people say about us through social media. So if you're a parent of a millennial or centennial, really listen to this stuff, because I want to speak from a millennial's perspective, and hopefully you can help your you know, loved ones who are in that sort of age bracket and generation, because this is really big. The number one, or I would say that one of the top three most frequent questions I get asked is, why is Gen Z and Gen Y, why are millennials, post-millennials, centennials, why are you guys the most depressed generation ever? And I always respond with the same answer. I don't have to give my opinion as to why I think we're depressed. The sociological data has shown us that one of the reasons we're so depressed is because of social media. Because that's where we're trying to find our identity. Did you know we pick up our phone once every six minutes, we pull out our phone, which equals 150 times per day. And when you get texts, likes, and notifications, it triggers the same dopamine loop in your brain that gambling induces. Because when you hear a text or an alert, you don't know if it's good or bad. You don't know if you're gonna win or lose. It's the same thing that happens when people gamble. It's like a high. You don't know if you're gonna win or you lose. And you get addicted to it. You're like, what did they say on my latest post or whatever? What text message is this? Is it good or bad? Am I gonna win or lose? Same dopamine loop in your brain neurologically that gambling induces. Like, why are my kids addicted to social media? The dopamine loop that's triggered in their brain by social media is the same dopamine loop produced by drugs. So it's addictive. And I'm going to talk about this a little bit later, but basically, social media is not a bad thing. It's actually a very good thing when you have it in its proper place. But we live in a generation where people are finding their identity in likes, texts, notifications, in people. Which 25% am I dealing with today? And Paul would learn very clearly that this is not a good way to live your life. Let's take a look at Acts 14. Very, very powerful stuff. And in Lystra, a certain man without strength in his feet. This is Luke 14, verse 8. Are you guys there? Are you guys in Luke 14, verse 8? Okay. And in Lystra, what'd I say, Luke? I did that last service too. Luke is the author. This is Acts 14. Are you guys in Acts 14? Okay. Technically, it kind of is Luke because he wrote it, but it's Acts. Acts 14, verse 8. And in Lystra, a certain man without strength in his feet was sitting, a cripple from his mother's womb. Everyone say mother's womb. Who had never walked. Everyone say never walked. This is one of only two. We'll stop here for just a second, then we'll continue. This is one of only two instances in the book of Acts where a man was revealed to have been paralyzed from birth, from his mother's womb. The only other time this happened was in Acts 3 when a guy was sitting at the gate beautiful. He was paralyzed, and it said also that he had never walked. So what did he do? He stood at the gate beautiful there at the temple, and he was asking for alms. He was asking for alms. He was asking for silver and gold. Kind of reminds me of that time I was on the freeway off of Ashland, and I saw this homeless guy with a sign in his hand. And the sign in his hand said, "The love of money is the root of all evil. Spare yourself from evil and give me all your money." Like, that actually makes me want to give him something because that was clever. But it's very strategic to beg in front of a church because, you know, we're supposed to be known by our agape. So when church people are coming out of the temple, it's like, that's the perfect place to beg. But notice what Peter said when he saw the man begging for alms. He said, "Silver and gold have we none, but in the name of Jesus Christ, rise up and walk." The story is told of the Pope at the Vatican was talking to an ascetic saint. He was walking the ascetic saint through the Vatican. He was showing all the wonders and splendors of the Vatican. If you've been to the Vatican, you've seen the Sistine Chapel and the marble that David was unearthed from by Michelangelo. He was showing him the marvels and splendors and wonders and beatific scintillating aesthetic beauty of the Vatican. And the Pope, who they believe the Pope in Catholicism is of the spiritual lineage that descends from Peter the Apostle, the Pope said, no longer can Peter say, silver and gold have we none, as he showed the riches of the Vatican. And the saint replied, and no longer, like Peter, can we say, in the name of Jesus Christ, rise up and walk. Cooked. He's like, you have a lot of riches, but you don't have the power. And Peter, he said, silver and gold have we none, but what he did have was something greater. He said, in the name of Jesus Christ, rise up and walk. Now that was the only, and the Bible says he was walking and leaping and praising God. Similar language is actually used of this man as well. Look at verse 9. So this man is the only guy along with the paralyzed man in Acts chapter 3 who was paralyzed from birth. This man, verse 9, heard Paul speaking, Paul observing him intently and seeing that he had faith to be healed, said with a loud voice, stand up straight on your feet, and he leaped and walked. I love this language, this rhetoric, this lingua franca in the Bible, where it doesn't just say like these paralyzed guys, like I would picture them like barely back creaking, never done this before, just barely like getting up. But that's not the language of the Bible. These paralyzed guys, the first thing they do is they're leaping. They're doing like Michael Jordan 40-inch verticals. Like, how are these guys already walking and leaping? That's the power of God. God did not mean you to merely get by. God meant you to leap. Thank you, Shay. I'm glad for that whistle. You're the only one who's with me this service. I love you. Joking. Here we go. Now, when the people saw what Paul had done, this is verse 11. They raised their voices, saying in the Lyconian language, the gods have come down to us in the likeness of men. And Barnabas they called Zeus, and Paul Hermes, because he was the chief speaker. Verse 13. Then the priest of Zeus, whose temple was in front of their city, brought oxen and garlands to the gate, intending to sacrifice with the multitudes. They need to make a really epic, big Hollywood budget movie of this. Here's Paul and Barnabas. Through the power of God, this guy, through their healing ministry, rises up and walks, and he's leaping. And the people of Lystra, the city wherein this is taking place, shout with their voices, it is the voice of a god, not of a man. The gods have come to visit us. Now, does this remind you of another story in the book of Acts? Remember Herod. Herod was giving a speech to some politicos and delegates who were wanting food stores. So they were looking to accrue favor out of Herod to assuage him to a place of giving them beneficiary economic gifts. And so Herod began to give a speech to the delegates. And the Bible says that they began to cry out, it is the voice of a god and not the voice of a man. It is the voice of a god and not the voice of a man. And Josephus actually tells us some BTS behind the scenes that Herod was dressed in like silver garments, and the silver would scintillate like a Labrador spar and jewel in the sun with sudden beauty. So he's in this beautiful silver garment with a golden throat and silver tongue. He speaks, the delegates are flatterers, the bane of every king throughout all of history, medieval and current and ancient. And the Bible says that when Herod received their praise, he got eaten by worms. Now, before you think of like a worm that ate Jonah's plant, his gourd, and Jonah's like, I want to die. The worm ate my gourd. I don't care about Assyria, 144,000 who don't know their right hand from their left, and all the beast and cattle besides. Like, I don't care if they're saved. God, you let this worm eat my plant. I love how that story ends. It's just so anticlimactic. It's so perfect of how like existential Jonah's mindset was. It's just Sisyphean and pointless, and God's doing something so much bigger. Don't picture necessarily a worm eating him. I mean, if you want to, you can. But some scholarship suggests that he had an intestinal worm, so he was eaten by like a sickness, like an intestinal worm. Whatever may be the case, he got this sickness and died. But what's super interesting to me is Herod received the praise, but as we'll see in a moment, look at what verse 14 says. When the apostles Barnabas and Paul heard this, they tore their clothes and ran in among the multitudes, crying out. They're like, don't do this. We're going to continue to read in a moment. They're tearing their garments. They're like, don't praise us as Zeus and Hermes. Why? Because back in ancient culture among Jews, if you tore your garment in grief, that was a sign that you would just experience some horrific travesty. And when you were rending your garment, it was a symbol that you were tearing and breaking your heart. That's why the prophet had to say, rend your heart and not your garments. Initially, rending your garments was a sign and symbol of rending your heart. Now, parenthetically, what was the garment that separated God's heart from the common folk? The Holy of Holies temple veil. And it says it split from top to bottom when Jesus died on the cross. And by the way, if you're here and you don't know Jesus, Ephesians 2 talks about being far off from God without hope. You know what the Lord says? The veil is torn. Come boldly to the throne of grace by faith to find mercy and help in time of need. The veil has been torn. It was as if the Father was grieving the fact that there was this barrier between him and the common folk. No longer just the son of Aaron, Yom Kippur, the high priest, the Day of Atonement, entering in once a year. Now everyone, the common people, can hear him gladly. And like John the Beloved, you can lean on Jesus' breast at supper time and hear the beat of his heart because the veil's been torn. You can lean up to his heart. You can lay on his breast. You can be chill with the Almighty and besties with the Maker. Hashtag no big deal, low-key world domination, salvation vibes. I don't know if I like golf claps or silence better, but I don't know. Is anyone happy about this good news, or this is good? This is good news. So notice, Paul and Barnabas, they're like tearing their garments, like crying out, don't do this. Now, it's interesting, they were continuously used by God, whereas Herod was eaten by worms. And you see that kind of disparate thing. I've learned the more I speak, just not to take things seriously. Like if people are like, that's horrible, I'm like, that's chill. You're entitled to your own opinion. You can be wrong if you choose. Joking. Where people are like, wow, Ben, thank you. I'm like, sick, sweet, thanks. But you just don't take it that seriously. Because people, as we'll see in a moment, are very fickle. So here's what's interesting. Notice how, look up at verse 12. Barnabas they called Zeus, and Hermes they called Paul. Why? Because Paul was the chief speaker. Now, I used to kind of think of this, and we'll continue on in just a moment. I used to kind of think of this as just random, very arbitrary and capricious. It's like, Paul, we call you Hermes, and Barnabas, we call you Zeus, because we are purple on the spectrum of spiral dynamics, so let's shake our rain stick and offer goat's blood and appease the gods. That's actually not all that's happening here. There's more beneath the surface that I want to kind of pull you down to. Notice how it says this is happening in Lyconium, specifically Lystra, and they're speaking in Lyconium dialect. The people of Lyconium had, around the city of Lystra, where this story's happening, they had a legend. They had a legend that Zeus and Hermes had once visited the land. And they couldn't find hospitality in all the land. They kept getting rejected because Zeus and Hermes, they were in disguise. And so that when they were seeking hospitality, when they were seeking a warm welcome, when they were seeking generosity, all of the citizens denied it to them, except for one old peasant couple by the names of Philemon and Baucis. Philemon and Baucis took them in, were very kind to them, even though they didn't know they were gods. And Zeus and Hermes, as a result, wiped out the entire population, except for Philemon and Baucis, because that was the only peasant couple that had showed them hospitality and generosity. So Zeus and Hermes wipe out the entire population, but they save Philemon and Baucis and then turn them into guardians there at the temple, and they turned them into great trees when they died. So Philemon and Baucis became great trees when they died. It's a tremendous honor. That was for you, Dad. I had to throw that one out there. You say you're barking mad, Ben, doing all these jokes. I know. Okay, I'm out on a limb here. Let's keep going. Okay, I'll leave these jokes alone. Okay, here we go. That's all I got. I don't have anything else. Like, thank you. So anyway, Paul and Barnabas, why are they called Zeus and Hermes? Because Hermes was the messenger god. And why does it say they called him Hermes? Because he was the chief speaker, the messenger. Barnabas they called Zeus, and scholarship suggests the reason for that is because Barnabas probably looked like a king. He probably had a noble, regal, stately, kingly bearing about him. But what happened in this story is, notice what the people of Lystra do. Their priest goes to the temple of Zeus. Why? Because who were the guardians of the temple? Philemon and Baucis turned into great trees. They were the people that showed Zeus and Hermes hospitality. So when this paralyzed guy from birth gets healed through Paul and Barnabas in the story, the people of Lystra speaking the Lyconian dialect, they're like, we don't want to make the same mistake as our ancestors, so we better honor Zeus and Hermes. We better show them generosity and hospitality so they don't wipe us out. That's why they went to the temple to offer sacrifices, because Philemon and Baucis were guardians of the temple. So that's the history behind what's happening here. So it's not just like they randomly said Zeus and Hermes. It's because they believe Zeus and Hermes had visited before. Now, let's go on. So they call them gods. They try to sacrifice garlands and oxen to Paul and Barnabas. But verse 14, when the apostles Barnabas and Saul heard this, they tore their clothes and ran in among the multitudes, crying out and saying, men, why are you doing these things? We also are men with the same nature as you, like Elijah, men of like passions, the same as you, and preach to you that you should turn from these useless things to the living God, who made the heaven, the earth, the sea, and all that is in them, who in bygone generations allowed all nations to walk in their own ways. Verse 17, nevertheless, he did not leave himself without witness in that he did good, gave us rain from heaven and fruitful seasons, filling our hearts with food and gladness. Now, stop right there and we'll continue in a sec. Notice how when Paul is in a Greek, Greco-Roman culture, what is he talking about? He's not talking about the Torah, the Septuagint, the Hebrew scriptures. He starts off talking about nature. God has not left himself without a witness. Creation testifies of a creator. What is that witness? That he gives rain for our crops. He gives us food and gladness. He made outer space, the heavens, the earth, the sea, all the sea creatures that are in them. The earth is 71% covered in water. 95% of those waters are unexplored. We know more about the surface of Mars than we do planet Earth, planet Earth's oceans. The oceans are a mystery. Paul says, look at the heavens, look at the earth, look at the sea, look at the rain, look at the crops, look at food and gladness that fills our hearts. He starts with nature. Why? Because even if people don't have any background in scripture, creation itself around them testifies of a creator. He has not left himself without a witness. Now, not to paint a mustache on the Mona Lisa, but if I see the Mona Lisa, I'm not like, what an amazing byproduct of fortuitous random events. I say, no, Da Vinci's fingerprints are all over it. That doesn't just happen. And when you see creation, it's very difficult not to believe in God. As Sir James Jean said, the famous astronomer, it's impossible to be an astronomer and an atheist simultaneously. Werner Heisenberg, the founder of the uncertainty principle, that you cannot predict both the position and momentum of quantum particles simultaneously, he said that when you take a first sip of the natural rational sciences, you're an atheist, but God is waiting for you at the bottom of the glass. It's like the more you go into this thing, goodness. I don't want to go into this, but just give me 30 seconds, because a lot of people don't like when I talk about science. Just give me 30 seconds. That's all I ask. Indulge me. We cannot reconcile Einstein's theory of relativity and the cosmic with Heisenberg and Planck's microcosmic quantum mechanics. What I mean is the microscope and the telescope do not align. They contradict each other. That's why Stephen Hawking, his whole life was a search for the unified theory of everything, because we can't explain why what we see through a microscope contradicts what we see through a telescope. We've never found a theory for quantum gravity. And here's the thing, even the simplest thing like mathematics is infinitely complex. That's why I don't believe in duality. I believe in infinite complexity when it comes to the universe. Here's what I mean. Did you know that Kurt Gödel, who worried himself sick when he was 71 because he wouldn't take food that was offered to him by anyone other than his wife? He literally worried himself to death because he starved himself to death because he kept thinking he would get poisoned and he would only take food prepared by his wife. So when his wife was hospitalized, he couldn't eat. And so he starved to death because he'd rather starve than be poisoned, even though no one was trying to poison him. The line between madness and genius is very thin. And Kurt Gödel, he found out, this is wild stuff. He was one of Einstein's best friends. Kurt Gödel found out that when you make the most simple arithmetic complex, and you begin to add equational intricacy to mathematical models, if you run it backwards, arithmetic itself starts to fall apart and 2 + 2 no longer equals 4. Even mathematics, you have to go into imaginary numbers and stuff. Even mathematics falls apart at a fundamental level. Even the universe itself, the strong and weak nuclear forces, electromagnetism, gravity. Gravity binds together the big. Electromagnetism binds together molecules. The strong nuclear force binds together the atomic nuclei of atoms. The weak force controls radioactive decay. All this stuff used to be in one single unified force called the initial singularity before time began, and nobody knows what happened before that. Like, the whole thing is a mystery, and let me put it very simply. Job and Solomon both said, and the psalmist, his ways are unsearchable. The works of God are past finding out. You think something simple like 2 + 2 = 4, and then Kurt Codell comes in and he says, actually, it doesn't work that way, and it's not that simple. You think you look up at stars and you're like, wow, I see stars as they are now. No, you're seeing stars as they were years and years and years in the past. And if you were living around one of those stars on a planet, you'd look at Earth and there'd be dinosaurs through your telescope. That's the theory of relativity, because that's how long light takes to reach the Earth. It's just crazy stuff. I mean, there are 40 billion Earth-like planets in our galaxy alone. There are 2 trillion galaxies now. There are more stars in space than there are sounds that have ever been uttered by all the humans who've ever lived. There are more stars in space than any... Than all the sands on any seashore. There are more stars in space than seconds have passed since the Earth is formed. This thing is huge. And what is Paul doing? He's like, look at the universe. Even though you're in Lystra and you have no understanding of the scriptures, let me just start with nature and then we'll take you to the scriptures. Look around. That's why I want to be a hope apologist. Like, I don't think there's hope apologists out there. Like, I want to give like an intellectual defending truth against all comers when it comes to hope being a reality. Look at the universe. He fills our hearts with food, with gladness, with rain for our crops in an agricultural society. The heavens, the earth, the sea, all the octopus in, is it octopi, plural? I don't know. All the anglerfish with light bulbs on the end of their heads. Look at creation around you. This thing's a miracle. Albert Einstein said, either you believe everything's a miracle or you believe nothing's a miracle. I tend to believe the former. Are you with me? I know I went off, I'm sorry. Some people are like, thank you for science, thank you. Then other people are like, stop talking about astrophysics. But I don't care, because I don't fear people. I'm joking, here we go. I wasn't joking about all the stuff I just said, that was big stuff. Okay, so he did not leave himself without a witness, nature. Verse 18, but even though he gave an eloquent speech, and with these sayings they could scarcely restrain the multitudes from sacrificing to them. This is where it gets good. The plot thickens. Then Jews from Antioch and Iconium came there, and having persuaded the multitudes, watch this, this is utterly insane, they stoned Paul. Who? The people who just tried to worship him as a god and sacrifice garlands and oxen from the temple of Zeus and just called him Hermes. These people stoned Paul and dragged him out of the city, supposing him to be dead. Verse 20, however, when the disciples gathered around him, I love this verse. He rose up and went into the city. What a boss. And the next day, he departed with Barnabas and to Derbe. Not going to cancel any flight. We're continuing our itinerant ministry. Even though I just got stoned with rocks, book that flight for tomorrow. Let's keep preaching. Verse 21, and when they had preached the gospel to that city and made many disciples, this is so good. If this doesn't send chills tingling up your spine, I don't think you're understanding what's being said. Verse 21, and when they had preached the gospel to that city and made many disciples, they returned to where? Lystra. Who just stoned him? Lystra. What a legend. Okay, I think that's super cool. Iconium and Antioch. What did they do? Strengthening the souls of the disciples, verse 22, exhorting them to continue in the faith and saying, we must through many tribulations enter the kingdom of God. There's no way around it. Can't circumnavigate it, can't circumvent it. This thing's not going to be easy. People are going to stone us, but through these many tribulations, we will enter the kingdom of God. I will not be moved, Paul said in Acts 20. I'm not moved. It's amazing to me the stuff that gets us down. She didn't like my Instagram post. Did you hear what he said on the comments? You should see the things people say to me on social media. It's unbelievable. It used to really get me down, and I'm like, you know what? I didn't get stoned with rocks, so shake it off. Shake it off. Here's the thing. There's so much to say here, and like I was gonna preach 20 minutes because like last time I was on, I preached for an hour and 6 minutes or something. Then the next week, my dad brilliantly taught for 8 minutes, and I'm like, man, what am I doing? I can't get down to 8 minutes. I'm trying, Dad. But there's just so much to say here, and I'm going to try to go just to the bare essentials. This story is so huge because 1 minute, the people say, "You're a God, let's worship you." The next minute, it's not even two chapters. It's literally like 14 verses. It's a few verses. And then they're changing their mind and they're saying, "These guys, Paul and Barnabas, they're worthy of death. He should be stoned. No longer is he Hermes. He's deserving of capital punishment." They stone him. Paul, they think he's dead, but Paul was so tough that he got up and dusted himself off. And he went right back into Lystra. JFK's final words in Dallas were, "See how Dallas loves us." And then he got shot. Now imagine JFK survived the assassination attempt with the curving bullet by Oswald or whoever it was. But imagine that JFK survived it and his brains are like, not to be too graphic, but his brains are like falling out. And then he goes, he's like, let's take the motorcade back into Dallas tomorrow. And let's go right back into the city and continue this campaign. You'd be like, that's not a good idea. That was Paul. He was stoned with rocks, left for dead, returns to the very city that stoned him, because what this generation needs are not people who look for the pity of their fellow featherless bipeds, but people who receive God's power. The path bifurcates and it's very clear. You can either get people's pity or you can get God's power, as my dad's taught us, but you can't get both at the same time. Now there's a time for compassion, receiving empathy, therapeutic, cathartic outlet, don't get me wrong. But I don't know if like you've ever had a time in your life where you could get pity and people were offering you pity. It feels really good for a day. And then you're left with a pity party and it's really depressing. So there comes a moment where you rise like a phoenix from the ashes. You rise like Job from sitting 10 days in the ashes. You rise like Paul from the outskirts of the city of Lystra. You wipe off the dust, you're bruised, battered, beaten, and bloody, and you go right back into the city. It's been said that John Wesley never feared to look a mob in the face. What we need are not people to pity us. What we need is power from the Prince of Peace. What we need, I'm preaching better than you're listening right now. What we need, I'm joking, but I'm serious about this point. What we need are good soldiers enduring hardship for Jesus Christ. Paul wrote that. He didn't say, "You go." He said, "Let's go." He said, Paul's saying, "Watch how tough I am." We need more of us. Good soldiers who endure hardship for Jesus Christ. We need soldiers. In other words, we don't need people who are like, "Let me feast on rainbow sandwiches, Pegasus steak, and float on unicorns shooting rainbows out of their eyes and get people's pity and throw a pity party." What we need is Navy SEAL Team 6, DEFCON 1, MI5, Rangers, paratroopers, Delta Force, good soldiers who endure hardship of Jesus Christ, who say, "I'm gonna fight a good fight. Hell will fear me. I'm gonna wage a good warfare. I'm gonna go to the gates of Hades and I'm gonna redirect traffic." Jesus said the gates of hell would not prevail against the church. The church's job is not to be weak. The church's job is to be known as an army, a generation that never quits, that marches on the gates of hell. The gates of hell is where the front lines go. Gates don't attack, they defend. That means we're playing offense. We're putting to flight the enemy. We're the ones actually charging the gates of hell. We need brave warriors. We need people who would say, "I would rather die on my feet than live on my knees and beg the enemy for help and beg him for mercy. I would rather go down in a blaze of shimmering glory, because if I share in his suffering, the Bible promises I will share in his glory." It's time for battle. This isn't a playground. This is a battleground. This isn't a cruise ship. It's a battleship. And as G.K. Chesterton said, we need to desire life like water. We need to drink death like wine. We need to be utterly fearless. 365 times the Bible says, "Do not fear." That is one for every day of the year. And we need people who will say, "I will not fear. I will be brave. I'm going to dust myself off. I'm going to rise back up. I'm going to go into the city of Lystra that stoned me, and I'm going to make disciples." Because we may go through many hardships, but through those hardships, we shall indeed of certitude enter the kingdom of God. Come on. That's what we need. That's what we need. I don't really care if I sound like a motivational speaker or a coach or a general, or you can call me whatever. I don't like any of those boxes. I'm just preaching to you the truth. This is what we need to hear. I don't know if this style is your style. I don't really care. This is what I believe. And it's not about what you say. It's about how you feel about what you say. This is big stuff, guys. This is big stuff. I know I'm not like the most calm person ever, but I don't know. Are we doing okay so far? Okay, let's go. Really quickly. Oh, that was fun. It's so much better going through life that way. So much better. It's so much better going through life with power than pity. Everyone please say, power is better than pity. Okay, you're with me. I love this. Now turn to Acts 28. It gets good. Acts 28. We'll go quick. Paul had just, he's a prisoner. And he got shipwrecked. And he was on the island of Malta. Euroclydon, this easterly wind, had blown him out to sea, and they shipwrecked on this island of Malta. And this is an exact replica of what happened in Acts 14, only in reverse. Let's take a look at Acts 28. Now, when they had escaped, verse 1, they then found out that the island was called Malta. And the natives showed us unusual kindness. Now, in your translation, when it says native, I'm using the New King James today, but if you're using the Old King James, it uses the word barbarous. They were barbarous people. Don't think of them as barbarians, like tribalistic warriors with face paint. Picture these people as natives who were on an island colonized and civilized because the Roman Empire and Pax Romana spreading out to the seas and warding the seas of pirates and coming to their island and colonizing them. Now watch this. What's super interesting about this to me is this. In the ancient world, anybody who didn't speak the eloquent, high-flown dictation of the Greeks were said to be barbarians because it's onomatopoeia, which means that the word sounds like the actual sound said word makes. So the Greeks believed that anyone who didn't speak their language, every other language sounded like barbar, barbar, barbar. So they called them barbarians. So they were using onomatopoeia. That's just what was happening. So it doesn't mean they were just like crazy, you know, tribalistic face paint witch doctors necessarily. I mean, these were natives of Malta who were colonized by the Romans. And the natives showed us unusual kindness, for they kindled a fire and made us all welcome because of the rain that was falling and because of the cold. Verse 3. But when Paul had gathered a bundle of sticks and laid them on the fire, a viper came out because of the heat and fastened on his hand. So when the natives saw the creature hanging from his hand, they said to one another, "No doubt this man is a murderer, whom though he has escaped the sea, yet justice does not allow to live." Now, this is crazy. I'm going to stop here for a minute because when I was reading this first service, this revelation came to me during the message. They said justice has caught up with Paul. Justice was their ancient Greek goddess of vengeance. Punishment fits the crime. Divine retribution. So some of your translations might capitalize the word vengeance has caught up with him, or justice. Justice or vengeance was the name of a Greek goddess that would offer divine retribution. Punishment fits the crime. And they said, vengeance has caught up with Paul because a viper has bit him. Now, evidently, this was a poisonous viper because the natives would have understood the flora and fauna of their land. And the fact that he didn't swell up and die, as we'll see in a moment, that baffled them. So this was evidently a deadly viper. But what did Jesus say? When you go out into all the world and you drink poisonous cups, they will not harm you. And when you are bitten by snakes, they will not kill you. And Paul is confirming this. But here's what hit me for service. They said, Paul is a murderer. Vengeance, the divine goddess, is offering divine retribution. Punishment fits the crime. Vengeance has sent a viper to bite Paul and to kill him. Now, I always thought of that as, well, that's not true. Paul was preaching the gospel. But wait a minute. Was Paul a murderer? Yes. That just hit me. Paul was a murderer. Remember in the book of Acts? The first martyr was murdered by the admission of Saul of Tarsus, renamed Paul. Paul was there when the peoples laid their garments at Paul's feet as he attested to the stoning of Stephen, they took off their coats because they were getting ready to hurl rocks at Stephen. Stephen's getting stoned to death, just like Paul outside Lystra. And he sees the heavens and he sees the Son of God standing at the right hand of the throne. Now, Jesus is never standing in heaven. You always see him sitting at the right hand of the throne of God. But in this case, he was standing. Why? Because, this is cool, as the hairs on Stephen's neck rose in fear, those hairs were giving God a standing ovation. And when Jesus saw Stephen suffering as a brave martyr, Jesus gave Stephen a standing ovation. Well done, good and faithful servant. Now watch. Saul was the one who assented to the murder of Stephen. Saul was a murderer. So what does vengeance do? Sends a snake to bite him. Who is the enemy in Genesis 3? A snake. What does he do? Accuses the brethren day and night before the throne of God. And this is where it gets crazy. The snake accusing the brethren day and night. Do you want to know what the word devil means in the original etymological language? It literally means, watch this, the accuser. It is a judicial term. It was a term used in court of law. We even use court of law terms today, devil's advocate. The word devil was used in the court of law, and it was used of an accuser, like a prosecuting attorney who was constantly accusing day and night. By the way, I have to clear this up because some people get mad at me for this. If you are a prosecuting attorney, we need people who are going to represent God and represent justice and going to clean up the streets. Don't get me wrong. You can't let Ted Bundy off the hook, okay? I get that. But what the enemy does is all he does day and night is he just accuses us before the throne, accuses, murderer. Might this have been going on in Paul's head? Murderer. The snake, more wily than any other creature, very good at being very bad, accuses day and night. The accuser, the adversary, court of law, he bites Paul. And what does Paul do? He shakes him off where? Into the fire. Because he is shaking off the accuser back into the fires of hell from whence he came. Because there is no condemnation. And no longer was Saul a murderer, persecutor of the church. Rather, he was a passionate preacher for the church. He was a new creature, a new species. There is grace for his race as he ran it with faith. I have run the race. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. So I will shake the snake back into the fires of hell from whence it came. I might be a murderer, but I'm not about vengeance or justice. I'm about mercy, because mercy is greater even than that. His grace is greater than my failing. Isn't that cool? So that's what happens here. And then look at what it goes on to say, and we'll begin our initial descent. However, they were expecting that he would swell up and suddenly fall down dead. This is verse 6. But after they had looked for a long time and saw no harm come to him, they changed their minds. Everyone said, change their minds. And said that he was a god. Okay. So, are you guys tracking with me on what's happening in these stories? Yes. Remember what I opened with. 50% of the people you meet will change their mind. They'll change their mind about you. The same people who applaud your coronation will applaud your beheading. The same city that says, Hosanna, save now, will say, crucify him later in the week. Same city. John 2 says, Jesus, when they began to believe on him for the many miracles he had performed, he did not commit himself to them. Another translation renders it, he did not trust them. Why? Because he knew what was in the heart of man, so he did not need man to testify of him. Why didn't Jesus trust people? He loved people, he didn't trust them, because he knew it was in the heart of man how fickle they are. So track with me. Let's make it very simple. Acts 14, they say Paul is a god worthy of praise. A few verses later, they change their mind and say, never mind, he's worthy of death, let's stone him. 14 chapters after Acts 14, Acts 28, the people of Malta say, he's a murderer worthy of death. And then they change their minds a few verses later and say, never mind, he's a god. Acts 14, they say, he deserves death. Pardon me. Acts 14, they initially say, he's a god. Then they change their minds and say, never mind, he should die. Acts 28, it's reversed. They say, he should die. And then a few verses later, they change their mind and say, nevertheless, he's a god. Do you see why Paul would have been driven crazy if he found his identity in what people said about him? If he wasn't fearless, like getting up after they stoned him, but if he was very insecure, what do you think about me? You think I'm a god? Let me get worship. And then he'd get eaten by worms. You think I'm deserving of death? Well, I'll just stay down in Lystra and I won't keep preaching. The same thing happens today on social media. This is like a prophetic moment message. Our generation is finding our identity in what people say about us on social media. Facebook, if you're baby boomer generation. Instagram, if you're millennial or centennial. And we're addicted to what people say about us. And what the Bible is showing is that's not a good idea. People are very mercurial. They're changeable. They're fickle. They will change their minds about you. Jesus didn't trust people. He's like, that's great that all these people are believing in my miracles. And I'm finding the older I get in life, like just taking a whole lot more things a whole lot less seriously. And people are like, that's so great. I'm like, sweet. They're like, you're horrible. I'm like, awesome. My identity is not found in what people say about me. People are not your dictionary. They don't define you. And this is coming from like an affirmation addict. In the five love languages, that guy's such a boss. What's his name? The guy who wrote that book. He's on the bestseller list every week after like 20 some years. I'm like, just such a legend. But it's like, my love language is word of affirmation. So I like encouragement. So coming from a fellow affirmation addict, I'm finding more and more that where peace is not in whether they stone you or praise you. Whether they say you should die, get bit by a viper, or let's sacrifice oxen and garlands to you. Whether they say Hosanna or crucify you. I want to say the fear of man brings a trap. Proverbs says, but those who trust in the Lord have safety. So what I like to do, I'm just kind of sharing my heart, is like, I like to just go in the presence of God. And as much as I like to say, oh, I'm praying for orphans in Gambia, that's great. I'm not selfless like that, like I should be. But I like to go in the presence of God and just let him love the heavens right into me. Last night, I just go up to the hills and I walk and I let God love me. And that's where my identity is. Mother Teresa was doing an interview with Dan Rather. And Dan Rather said, when you talk to God, what do you say? And she said, I don't say anything, I listen. And Rather said, okay. When God talks to you, what does he say? Mother Teresa said, he doesn't say anything, he listens. Rather looked confused. And she said, if you don't understand it, I can't explain it to you. Deep calls into deep. And when you just go in the presence of God, and not how can I get out of the way? It's about me. How can I get out of the way? How can I remove myself? How can I get rid of no. You love me so much. And when you let God love the heavens right into you, he who kneels before God can face any man. That's where security comes from. That's where identity comes from. So when they worship you, you're not gonna get eaten by worms. You're not gonna take it seriously. When they criticize you, you're gonna say, that's cool too. It's not vengeance, it's about grace. I was a murderer, but now I'm a preacher, so awesome. God loves me. And here's what I wanna say as I begin our descent. The truth of the matter is, man, I'm sorry, guys. It's 45 minutes, and I'm like trying to go shorter. Please don't come to me afterwards and say, "Oh, we want you to go longer," because I know there's a minority who wants me to go longer. But for the majority here, I know I'm going long. I'm trying not to. I'm working on it. Grace. I'm thankful for that. At least I didn't kill Stephen. Okay, here we go. I'm drawing to a close. With social media, I need to say this. This is where our identity is coming from. So when people say absurd things that hurt us or crazy praise that's too much for us, either way, it shouldn't affect us. Why? Because a good thing becomes a bad thing if you worship it as a lowercase God thing. So we have iPhones, which is our new idolatry. We pull out our phone once every 6 minutes, 150 times per day. But technology is not a bad thing. You understand that, right? Social media is not bad. To attack social media is a pointless endeavor. Here's what I mean. Paul used technology. He used the Persian mailing system, the Roman roads, the dictation of letters. He used the highest technology of his day. And I think it's funny when churches are like, yeah, Ben, why are you doing, you know, media stuff? Because we don't use technology. I'm like, okay, do you use a microphone? Well, yes. Then you are using technology from the 1940s. You're just 90 years late or 80 years late. Do you have lights? Yes, we use electricity. Great. You're using technology from Thomas Edison's day. You're just a little behind the curve, but you are using technology. technology is not the enemy. The march of technology of progress is going to happen whether you like it or not. The question is, are you going to be like Paul and use technology to become all things to all men that you might win some? And all technology does is expand upon already present human capacity. So let me explain. This microphone is technology. It did not invent the vocal cords. It just made vocal cords louder. It just expands on already present human capacities. I could talk to you without a microphone, but this microphone makes my voice louder. A car, my Jeep that I drove out here, that Jeep did not invent motion. It just makes motion go faster. It accelerates motion. Social media did not invent connection. Social media just made us more connected. No longer is it 7 degrees to Kevin Bacon. It's like 2 degrees to anybody. We all know each other, or we all have mutual friends through social media. Do you ever look at who other people follow that you follow? You're like, they know that person? So we're all connected. Social media didn't invent fellowship. It didn't invent connection. It just increased it. So it's a good thing. But if you turn up the volume too loud on any technology, what happens is it collapses in on itself and destroys the very thing it was intended to create. Watch this. If you turn up this microphone too loud, you're going to hear ringing. It's called feedback. Have you ever heard feedback? When the microphone's too loud and it's ringing in everyone's ears, it then becomes harder to hear me because I have to speak over the ringing, so it's better if I don't use a microphone at all. If you take a car, yes, it accelerates the already present human capacity of motion, but watch, have you ever turned up the volume too loud on cars? Have you ever been to Los Angeles at 5 p.m. on a Friday? Question, do cars make you go faster or slower? Slower. Rush hour traffic, you can walk faster than you can drive. Social media, same thing. It did not invent connection. It does connect us, though. It expands our connection. But if you turn up social media too loud, now that we're reaching for a phone once every 6 minutes, 150 times per day, if that's where you're finding your security, now brain scientists are trying to tell our generation, if you spend more than 2 hours a day on social media, it's bad for your brain, because that's like the low bar is 2 hours. Like, can we limit ourselves to 2 hours per day of social media? So whether or not we talk about social media, it is prevalent in this generation. It's happening all around us. So I want to speak right to the issue. The truth of the matter is this. A good thing becomes a bad thing when we exalt it to a lowercase God thing. Because if you worship social media and find your identity in what the people of Lystra or Malta or on social media are saying about you, then what happens is it destroys the very connection it was intended to create by making us compare rather than connect. So now everyone always asks me, why is your generation so depressed? I say, I don't have to give an opinion. The sociological data and research has shown us it's because, watch this, of social media. That's what the data is showing us. Social media is one of the things that has caused us to be so depressed. We're comparing ourselves with each other, and now we're trying to find our identity in one another, and we're fearful, we're confused. Our generation has identity issues. We're insecure. We don't know who we are because we're forgetting Acts 14, Acts 28, and John 2. We're forgetting these classic texts. Proverbs, the fear of man brings a snare. You have to find your identity in the love of God. And 1 John 4 says his love is perfect. He loves you. Even if you had spelling errors in your last caption, he loves you. Even if your post was super narcissistic and everyone knows it, he loves you. Even if she didn't like your latest post, he loves you. Even if you lost all your followers on Facebook or whatever Facebook does, he loves you. He loves you. And the Bible says in 1 John 4, his perfect love casts out fear. Lystra's love is imperfect. They may call you God for a second, but just wait, they'll stone you. Malta's love is imperfect. They might call you a God, but only after they said that viper should kill you. What we need is a generation who, like Paul, will get rocks thrown at us and it doesn't faze us because we know who we are. We are children of God. And nothing can separate us from his love. That is why our generation needs a bunch of God-fident Applegators who will go out into the Rogue Valley and people are like, man, you guys are confident. Man, you guys are bold. My favorite verse right now in the Old Testament at the moment is the book of Proverbs when it says, the righteous are bold as lions, but the wicked flee when no man pursues. The righteous are bold as a lion, but the wicked flee when no man pursues. The wicked are like fleeing when no one's even running after them. If previous generations saw us crying and worried over our phone, they'd be like, you are fleeing when no one pursues. What are you scared of? Phantom digital enemies, haters on Instagram? Mark Twain said, I have had a great and many troubles, most of which have never happened. The future of our reality is seldom as bad as the future of our fears, but the righteous are bold as a lion. Why? Because 1 Peter says, our enemy is like a roaring lion. He's not a roaring lion. He just pawns himself off like one with paws, a roaring lion, when he's an angel masquerading himself, an enemy masquerading himself as an angel of light. Don't get confused. Be not ignorant of the enemy's devices. He looks like a roaring lion. He's like one, but the real lion is in Revelation, the lion of the tribe of Judah. That's why C.S. Lewis called Jesus Aslan in his allegory, because Aslan is the Persian word for lion, further up, further in. Paul said, when you speak, speak as the oracles of God. We are bold as lions roaring forth the oracles of God. Our generation needs a bunch of fearless people who let God's perfect love give us our identity, and that perfect love casts out the fear of man, which brings a snare. I'm going to show you a quick video that Jeff put together. I'll make one remark, and then we'll be on our way. But we try every single day on Instagram, every single day on Facebook, every other day on YouTube to post something that will give people hope, to redeem this mechanism to affirm people's identity in the love of God rather than trying to get it through mere fickle humanity. And this is one of the things we posted today. So I just want to encourage you with this message. So like Paul, we would be fearless. More than a wishbone is a backbone, because the brave desire life like water and drink death like wine. Through courage, Jonathan and his armor bearer climbed up a mountain, and despite their strategical disadvantage, they wiped out 20 Philistines, though the odds were stacked against them 10 to 1. Through courage, David, when commanded by Saul to kill 100 Philistines and bring back their foreskins, this was supposed to kill David, he goes out and kills 200 Philistines and brings back twice as many foreskins just for kicks. Through courage, Abishai lifted up his spear and killed 300 enemy warriors in a single battle. Through courage, Jonathan, David's nephew, 40 years after his uncle killed Goliath, he fought a giant with six fingers on each hand and six toes on each foot and defeated him. Through courage, Benaiah chased a lion down into a snowy pit, and despite the slippery ground, he caught it and killed it. Through courage, Benaiah fought a mighty Egyptian warrior who was armed with a spear. Benaiah only had a club. He wrenched the spear out of the Egyptian's hand and killed him with his own weapon. Through courage, Eleazar fought an entire Philistine army by himself and won as his hand clave into the sword. Through courage, Shamgar lifted up his ox goad and killed 600 Philistines with it. Through courage, Samson lifted up the jawbone of a donkey and killed 1,000 Philistines with it. Through courage, Jashobeam lifted up his spear and defeated 800 enemy warriors in a single battle. Through courage, Gideon took his 300 men and put to flight 135,000 Midianites. Through courage, Jesus Christ, the captain of our salvation, when at the crossroads, took the road to the cross. As fear was seeping through his pores in the form of blood, he said, not my, but thy will be done. Embrace the cross, despise the shame. As the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, he put death to death. So we don't have to be scared to death of death. And at the place of the skull, he crushed the skull of the serpent with the crown of thorns on his skull. And the Bible says, through God, we shall do valiantly. So like these Bible characters in days of eld and halcyon days of yore, let's be brave. That on our TV show? Why do we put that on social media? Because social media is a good thing. Media is a good thing. But the problem is what's happening in like the news is they repeat their own newsfeed every 30 minutes and it leads with bad news. So we want to infiltrate the media with good news. Social media has a lot of comparison. Let's infiltrate it with like courage. We want to use this thing to impact our generation. Let's be bold like lions. That's what our generation needs. So my friends, let us go our way hearing the words of God And that was all scripture right there. Those are all just scriptural stories of fearlessness. Let's be like Paul, bitten by a snake, shakes it off, dusting himself off when stoned by the people of Lystra. Let's hear the words of God. Be strong and of a good courage. Do not be afraid, nor be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you. Wherever you go, he has not given you the spirit of bondage again to fear, but the spirit of adoption whereby we cry, Abba, Father. We have not been given the spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. The wicked flee when no man pursues, but the righteous are bold as lions, because the line of the tribe of Judah is roaring forth the oracles of God through our vocal cords. So we're not going to fear the one who pawns himself off like a roaring lion. We know that his head has been crushed. We can shake the serpent back into the fires of hell. He's the accuser of the brethren, but there is no condemnation. There is grace. So we're going to run our race with faith. We're going to go through life roaring, bold as lions, because that's who God has called us to be. Can I get an amen?